The Commission on Appointments has approved the designation of Enrique Manalo as Philippine Foreign Affairs Secretary. During the confirmation hearing, lawmakers grilled Manalo about his stance on several issues, like the dispute over Saba. Senator Francis Tolentino said the DFA should seize the opportunity to stake the Philippines' claim in Saba following the legal victory of the heirs of the Sulu Sultanate against the Malaysian government. According to Manalo, prior to his appointment and before the start of the new administration, the government already had a cluster committee that studied the impact of that award. The secretary said he plans to reconvene the body to continue its assessment. Meanwhile, 15 appointees of President Marcos were bypassed by the Commission on Appointment due to a lack of time. The list includes Finance Secretary Benjamin Jokno, Social Welfare Secretary Erwin Tulfo, and Social Economic Planning Secretary Arsenio Balisacan. The first regular session of Congress is set to pause from October 1 to November 6. Senate President Miguel Zubiri said these officials would now have to seek reappointment from Marcos. Hurricane Ian unleashes heavy rains and strong winds in Florida as it makes landfall as a Category 4 storm. Ian quickly transformed Florida's sandy beaches into a disaster zone inundated by seawater. It is one of the most powerful storms to hit the U.S. in recent years. According to a U.S. tracker, some 1 million households have already lost power due to Ian. The National Hurricane Center has warned of catastrophic damage and flooding, with a storm packing winds of up to 150 miles per hour. That's just 7 miles shy of Category 5 intensity, the strongest on the scale. Before slamming into Florida, Hurricane Ian devastated Cuba. At least 2 were reported dead. The U.S. Border Patrol also said at least 20 Cuban immigrants are missing after their boat sank. 4 survived by swimming to the shore in the Florida Keys, while 3 were rescued by the U.S. Coast Guard. Here at home, the death toll from Typhoon Karding in the Philippines climbs to 10, as 2 more fatalities are reported Wednesday. The new fatalities were reported in Baliwag, Bulacan and Tanay, Rizal, both of which were due to drowning. 8 others remain missing. Officials in storm-hit areas are appealing for government aid as the damage estimates grow even further. According to the Agriculture Department, Karding left 1.3 billion pesos worth of damage to the sector as flooding hit rice-producing provinces.
Majority po dyan is yun sa palay, sa niyog, at saka po sa mga sagingan. Ang pangunahin po dito ay syempre yung palay at yung kopra po. And estimate po namin na time po para po makabalik po ulit sila sa dati po nilang activities ay siguro mga 6 months to 1 year.
Kung maaari, matulungan yung mga kababayan ko. Ako naman po kasi, eto, hindi naman kaila na tayo halos mahigit 2 taon na nanggaling sa COVID. Ngayon lang pala tayo nagtatayo gusto nating makabalikwas, makabawi-bawi. Inabutan na naman tayo ng bagyo. Panibagong sakripisyo na naman yung haharapin natin ito. Kung makakatulong sila sa dito sa akin bayan, ngayon pa lamang po, ako'y nagpapasalamat na.
Meanwhile, the estimated damage in Bulacan due to Karding pegged at around 1.2 billion pesos. But Governor Daniel Fernando says they're holding off on declaring a state of calamity in the province until they get a clearer picture on the scale of the impact on their infrastructure. But he admits their calamity funds may not also be enough.
Meron naman pong dudukutin na yes, meron naman po.
Meron naman.
Talaga pong kulang na kulang talaga. And hihingi talaga tayo ng suporta. End of the year na eh, di ba? Nauubos na yung ating mga ginamit sa COVID, sa gamot.
In other news, the Philippine House of Representatives has approved the government's record-high budget of 5.29 trillion pesos for 2023. The Departments of Education and Public Works got the lion's share of the budget, with around 700 billion pesos each. 289 House lawmakers voted in favor of the spending bill, while 3 progressives voted against it. They believe the proposed budget fails to address the country's most pressing problems. They spent a considerable amount of time trying to convince their colleagues to realign a portion of the surveillance and anti-insurgency funds to social services.
Majority or 50.2% ng budget ng Office of the President para sa susunod na taon ay para sa confidential and intelligence funds. Mas dihamak na mas malaki kaysa dun sa Office of the Vice President. Speaking in another way, 7 times yung confidential and intelligence funds sa Office of the President.
Ang dahilan po niyan, Mr. Speaker, dear colleague, as head of state and government, the President of the Republic of the Philippines plays a central role in national security management and decision-making, primarily in terms of giving broad guidance and impetus to the formulation and implementation of national security policies.
The budget bill will now be submitted to the Senate. House Speaker Martin Romualdez is hoping senators will also take haste in passing it after President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. certified the measure as urgent.
We are confident that our good senators will also act with dispatch in having this most important piece of legislation approved in order for both houses to ratify the budget bill in time for the signature of the President before of the end of the fiscal year.